you can't just trust agents to go and act on your behalf, because fundamentally they're working, at least today, in a low context environment, a low information environment. Hi, I'm Ben Scharfstein. I lead product for our enterprise team at Scale. And today I'm joined by my colleague, Felix. Felix, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Hey, I'm Felix. I lead the engineering team here on the enterprise AI team.
Nice. Excited to get started. Today we're going to be talking about the agent landscape, some recent developments, kind of how it's relevant for enterprises who are building agents. To start off, Felix, you know, I think agents are like a buzzword, and I would say we even use them very freely at Scale to describe things that maybe technically aren't agents. How would you describe an agent? How would you define it?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think like, you know, I think traditionally there's two different types of things that are being built. So a lot of there's workflows, right? Which is like the more traditional, do a set of things, use an AI in between. But then there's agents. Agents, the way we define it here is they do four things. They do reasoning, which is the ability to navigate a complex task. They do planning, which is the ability to choose what steps to take. They also have memory and state, so they can remember what's done and all the different things that it's working on. And then it can also execute tasks, right? So these are kind of like the four things. And the way I like to think about it is basically how like an agent is our modeling of human behavior, allowing an agent to make those steps and take those decisions. But yeah, I mean, how would you kind of define agents, or what are different things that you think are compelling that people have been building in the industry today that are agentic?
Yeah, I mean, I think you're right. And you know, the analogy I think for the agent is like, imagine, you know, you have like a dune buggy that you can drive anywhere, right? It can go anywhere, it can take information from the environment, and it can just react and make decisions. And then critically, I think execute tasks. Some of the cool stuff I think that people are doing with agents is bringing them into the real world. You know, we saw Manus like got a bunch of steam and a bunch of attention on X the other last, you know, a couple weeks ago for like blowing people's mind. Obviously there's operator and computer use from OpenAI and Anthropic respectively. You know, there's lots of cool things where I think, you know, when we see the demos of people using agents, they blow people's minds. I mean, I think in production, you know, we're still at the demo phase. So I'm not sure that I've seen, you know, super exciting things on the consumer side that I'm like, this agent is blowing my mind. But I think on the builder side, you know, as we think about what's going viral on Twitter, definitely on the framework side, there's like a ton. On the demo side, there's a ton. I mean, maybe like talk about some of those frameworks. You know, we hear about MCP, agent to agent, like lane graph, like what are all these things? Like, how can we explain them?
Yeah. I think, you know, the builder space, the way that I see kind of like this industry kind of panning out is I see it kind of like a funnel, right? There's the builder space, and then there's people who are getting a little more serious and thinking about, okay, you know, I need tracing and observability of all of my different things. And then I need to evaluate the production quality of something before I release it. And then I need to guardrail it. And then I need humans in the loop, right? And so you see this really, really big funnel, right? Where you're kind of like distilling down things. And this funnel we care about in enterprise, right? But, you know, the internet and everyone is kind of in the top bubble, right? It's like the builder space. How can I build a million things really, really quickly? And so you get things, like you said, MCP, agent-to-agent, link-to-agent. And the purpose of all of these things is just to make it easier to do things, right? So MCP is a way for me to kind of like interact with the world. We talk about task execution for agents, right? MCP suddenly makes it like really easy for me to say like, okay, here's a defined way to interact with an environment, right? Whether it's a VM, whether it's your file system, whether it's Slack, whether it's Google Drive. And I can really quickly kind of latch an LLM on top and be like, now you are not just smart, but you have capabilities, right? And that's really, really powerful. But, you know, like I said, this is kind of like in this enterprise space, you know, it's not just about capabilities, but it's about control. And this is something we're going to talk about in future episodes about, you know, capturing data, understanding, you know, every single step of the way, what are compounding errors that you can have, and allowing us to build like very, very precise systems that allow us to kind of prevent compounding errors, right? And this is why scale has a business, because this is what we're good at. What's your opinion on kind of these different aspects and how it affects us and how we build things?
I think agents today, at least, are good at implementing decisions that have been made. And so if you give it a very spec'd out design document, this is exactly how I want it to work. And it, you know, it doesn't even need to be pseudocode. It can just be basically telling it the trade-offs that you want to make. Then it can be very good at implementing those things. And I think as we see reasoning models, it's getting better and better and better. Because what reasoning models do, and I think O3 just dropped today, is that they can break down the task into smaller and smaller subcomponents and really understand what are the decisions that need to be made versus just the implementations that need to be done. I think the reason that probably, you know, you're not having complete success where we just like, you know, describe a problem and then get an answer is that there is a lot of preference and there's a lot of external context that goes into designing a system. And there's so many different nuances that it would be impossible for an coding agent to know those nuances. And I think this is, you know, there's two kind of important outcomes of this. One is that you can't just trust agents to go and act on your behalf, because fundamentally they're working, at least today, in a low context environment, a low information environment. Despite the fact that you might give access to your entire code base, we know that a code base is not nearly enough information to understand the requirements of a system, right? If it were, we could just have completely distributed jobs, have no need for meetings, right? And we could just hire people all around the world that never need to talk to each other and don't have access to Slack. But obviously that's not what happens, right? Like there's a reason that we communicate outside of just, you know, pull requests. And I think that's really important, right? It's like, you can't just trust these things. And what that means is that you need to have ways of understanding what's going on. And you need to have guardrails around different kind of pause points or breakpoints where you say, hey, actually, this is a really critical decision. I want to make sure that I am leveling up and going back to the user and asking what's going on. But even more kind of abstractly, I think, as we're developing agents, it's really important to basically have surgical precision as to what's going on at every step. And, you know, I know this is like a really big focus for the Scale Gen AI platform, is how do we give that observability and the monitoring into agentic systems? So it's not just, you know, reasoning agent and the ability to write code and everything else is just code at the other end. But like, what are all the steps in between? What's the skeleton that needs to be built to give it the right guardrails? Maybe that skeleton is reducing over time. Like, we need to have fewer and fewer areas where we're directing it. But at the same time, we still need just as much observability and monitoring. And like, you know, how does SGP or the Scale Gen AI platform help with that? And then I have a second point that I'll make after you answer that one.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, like you said, I think surgical precision is the word of the day there, right? I mean, like, you know, you have these systems that are doing some work, but like I said from before, I mean, they have compounding, issues, right? I think this morning I was emailing back and forth with one of our clients at a financial firm, and he was talking about some papers or some blog post that Anthropic released about how chain of thought reasoning is still fundamentally stochastic, and that causes these agents to have like unpredictable behavior, right? And so, you know, yeah, you need to police these things, right? And I latched onto something you said kind of earlier on in your response, which was fundamentally you can't let these agents like run completely amok, because a lot of these decisions are preferential, right? So if you think about it, there's actually this like this kind of fundamental issue with model builders where they're kind of like capturing the world, the state of the world. But fundamentally within an enterprise, you're not an average of all the things in the world. You've built an opinionated way to do something, right? That's what makes you a business. That's how businesses are made. You build an opinionated moat as to how you do stuff, and then you can become a business, right? And so this is why the Gen AI platform is critical, right? Like, you have to take a model that's fundamentally, you know, made as some sort of average across the world with maybe some, you know, there's some tuning and stuff like that, but it's you know, you can kind of generalize it to say it's an average of the world's information, and you're trying to apply it to a specific thing and forcing it down a certain set of behaviors. So when you want surgical precision, you need to be able to capture all the data inside of people's heads. You need to download that information. You need to review the way that they use the agent. You need to capture all the clicks that they make, all the things that they do, all the tools that they would do in that specific situation. And you need to conform the AI system to that behavior. And it's really important to think of these things as AI systems, because you know, you can control it in different ways. You could fine-tune a model. You can do in-context learning. You can do memory. You can put things in vector DBs and dynamically retrieve them based on past upvotes and downvotes. If, you know, like, there's so many ways. And this is why it's really important for our team to do this custom work for enterprises, because fundamentally, you start with a foundation of a model, and you need to build an AI system on top of it, connect it to your data, and then model it after the humans that you have trained, right? And that's what the Gen AI platform is useful for. You need to have all that data captured somewhere in order for us to do something with it, right? So, you know, for enterprises, it's actually super critical for this to happen. You said you had a follow-up, actually.
Yeah. That actually leads perfectly into kind of the second point that I wanted to make, which is that your AI system is not just an agent, but it's an agent that works in the context of an application, and the application is trying to help someone accomplish a task. And that application could be an entirely backend application, but it has to hook into other things. And oftentimes it's a full stack application. You can think of kind of the intermediate, that's kind of like level 3, level 4 agents on the path to autonomy as kind of co-pilots that are augmenting human workflows and doing the parts that don't require decision-making or preferences, right? Like, I think we talked about this, you were talking about they're the average. I would say it slightly differently, which is they're not the average of quality, but they're unopinionated on trade-offs,
Yeah. Right?
And I think that's the key thing, is that two very smart people can make different trade-offs, and an LLM doesn't have a prior on which one to make. And so, you know, you have to give it that information of what are the trade-offs that you want to make. And I think this is really where it's super important, not just to build high quality AI, but also to build really strong human computer interfaces and applications that allow you to control and interact with the agent in the right way. And I think this is the thing that Cursor really got right very early on, which is that they thought of this as a full system and application, and not just we're trying to build a coding agent that does your job, but we're building a coding agent that is feedback. It's something that you can touch and feel, you can see what's going on, and it asks clarifying questions. And that is the type of design that people are starting to build, and that we really focus on building into agentic systems, which is, it's not about just the agent being really good on evals. It's about the system being really good at accomplishing the task with the human in the loop, and eventually becoming autonomous or becoming less and less reliant on the human, but still coming back to them for preferences and decisions.
Yeah. And something that you mentioned, I think, you know, I was talking to a connection the other day about AI controls. How do you control their behavior, right? And I said something that I'm going to repeat here, which is, you know, building really, really good AI is not just an AI problem, but it's a product problem. Then I'm curious kind of your take. I mean, you're kind of leading some of this product stuff for our customers. You know, how do you think about the handoff between, oh, this is an AI problem and this is a product problem?
This really comes down to like getting with people that do the job today and understanding, how do you do this? What's the information that you use to make your decision? Not listening to their feature requests, but listening to their problems and listening to their thought process, and then modeling that as much as you can as agents, and then understanding, okay, where are the areas where three smart people might not agree, right? Where there's not a deterministic way to do this, but what we're trying to do is capture what the best people do, the best people that enterprise, the thing that differentiates that company. We need to capture those people's decision-making, and we can only capture the human decision-making. We can't capture the agent's decision-making, and then we can move it into agents. But I think that's, you know, it's a moving target for sure. But it's something that, you know, this is basically what I spend all my time thinking about, is how do we build solutions that solve problems, not just agents that solve problems, but full solutions that incorporate agentic workflows and solve problems.
Yeah. And I think something that's that's super important is like these human interactions are basically like a reset point, right? We've talked about compounding errors where if I let Cursor to run for like 2 hours, I guarantee I'm going to be upset with it when I come back, right? But resetting at these checkpoints allows me to go from, okay, if every decision is 50% accurate, I'm going to have a very bad time if I let 10 decisions go through unchecked. But if I reset that 50% decision back to 100% because I checked my work there, then we can continue that chain of 50% and not compound the error, right? And so that's definitely something that that's really important when as these agents get more and more complex.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, like we say, quality is fractal, right? This is one of our mottos at scale. And so when you can reset, you know, it will improve the quality of the entire system. Mm-hmm. All right, that's all we have for the discussion today on the current landscape of agents, what matters for enterprises, and what's the latest. Next week, we'll get more into the technical discussion about challenges of building agents in the enterprise that Felix and I discussed. Subscribe so you don't miss it.